systematic reviews, but we also fund practice-based research. So I don't know how much I will be able to talk about here. It's a lot, so we'll just see. About half an hour, is it? So we are a government agency, we started in January 2005, so definitely the newest version of the Nordic company here. And this is from our instruction, which is the main document for the Swedish governmental agency, that we should contribute to teachers and other relevant professionals capacity to plan, perform, and follow up learning and teaching practice based on the practice evidence, and contribute to children's and pupils' development and learning. So that's our sort of main purpose. It is a very clear cut. We know exactly what we should do, really. And I think it's important to point out here that our mission is that firsthand directed to be relevant for practice for teachers. Which, and when I say teachers, I mean preschool teachers as well. I don't say that every time. And then for policy, which differs a little bit from service organizations, which are more directed towards policy. There are commonalities between directing your systematic reviews towards teachers and policy, in the sense that they have to be presented in a different way than in a research context. But otherwise, of course, the questions are very different. You are on very different levels in the system. And our aim is to be as close to the teaching situation as possible in our systematic reviews. So in practice, what we do, I'm sorry about these yellow, somebody looked over my PowerPoint over the weekend and apparently she happy with everything. So obviously I should do something about the yellow parts. Anyway, we do systematic reviews primarily. We can do other things as well, other types of research summaries and mappings and so on and so forth, but we haven't had the time. That's a simple reason for that. We should also mediate our results. And the other thing, as I said, we also fund research with relevance to practice. Next line there, we should also identify, this is still from the instruction, identify areas where there is a lack of research relevant to practice. From these 2.5 years now, when I've been in the school situation, I come from higher education, I've been working for higher education issues for many, many years, quality assurance and all sorts of things, I'm associate professor of psychology. And the school, I've been working with teacher education, but I haven't really been in the school setting before. So after 2.5 years of working with these issues, of course I've seen a number of interesting things. And when it comes to funding research, we don't need to identify any specific areas because there is hardly any practice-based research going on. So my main task here when it comes to funding research is to actually create a profile to actually finance research that is relevant for teachers in their practice. I see also that the major shortcomings here is when it comes to systematic reviews, point two, that there is a lack of competencies to use existing research in schools. I will come back to these things, and I think maybe we come back to them in the discussion as well, if we want to do some sort of needs analysis here. And I can just back what Sylvie just said, we lack the infrastructure to distribute. So I'll come back to these issues. But anyway, main point is that we do systematic reviews and we fund research, practice-based research. We're a small organization, we're 15 people. I don't think we have to delve into that very much more, really. When it comes to the systematic reviews, our aim is to find out not to we need to know what works, why does it work, with whom, in what context. And of course, we take into consideration also, and I can say from the beginning, that we have been collaborating from the very beginning. I was very happy to meet Sylvia at a conference in London in the network, almost just a few months after I started. And so we meet up our organizations now and again with everyone and discuss issues around methods. And of course, the type of research within this area is so different from medical research. You need to take into account all the qualitative stuff as well. Mm-hmm. And then you need to develop your methods to synthesize. So we've been working together with that and elaborating on the possibilities to make configurative analysis. The current reviews we are working with, I brought, I suppose it is for you also, Turing. You can download them online. These are the first reviews, and I think one has already disappeared.
Sorry. Yeah, because I only brought them as examples, actually. You can have it back later. These are the first ones. ICT Education in Mathematics, which we published in November. The first one, actually, Class 9 in Mathematics Education, which we published in October. They were pretty much ready at the same time, but you can't launch two things at the same time. This is the one, which is Classroom Dialogue in Mathematics. This is a synthesis of purely qualitative research, actually. And as far as I know, we haven't done any evaluations of this or follow-ups or anything yet, but from what I've heard, it is found to be very useful for teachers. It really is in the middle of the classroom. This one is the same, but it's two reports, because it covers preschool and all secondary gymnasium. And this is about ICT education and mathematics. This one is purely quantitative. Randomized control trials in this. We didn't plan it like that, but I think it's very good because in this field, both when it comes to the school system, but when it comes to the whole research community, you know, there's a lot of strong opinions. You know, it's only one thing that is good, and it's the stuff that I'm doing. It's either resulting or it is, or either qualitative stuff. You know, like this. So I've found from the very beginning that for an institute like this, it is very, very important to not just put your feet into one of these cultures. You really need to be open when it comes both to what research and the type of reviews you do, and also, of course, the type of research that we are funding. We are working with science instruction for second language learners, and feedback methods, reading comprehension strategies. We're doing one for preschool and we're starting up one for adult education now in a few weeks. So the next step, of course, to go from the report to the dissemination and implementation, there are a number of challenges there. And I think these ones you really need to take into account in this further work as well. It's one thing to gather the research. It's one thing to do some really high quality reviews. But what about the next step? Of course, the report format is the first main point that you need to think about. And it's not very easy to get people who are used to write research literature to even sort of put the methods part at the end of the report. Or we've had some discussions, you won't believe it. but of course, the language is very, very important. You need to really think about that. We have worked with reference persons tied to each project. Each report in a very small format so far, but that needs to be developed, and you need to engage them from the very beginning, not because they have so much to say in the very beginning, but they need to have some sort of ownership. So that's one way of they definitely do not read research articles. That's basic. There's very few teachers who actually do that. And then we have, which was, this is really new to me, was new to me. We talk a lot about research, and we talk about, it was cited here, what we have in the Educational Act, that education should rest on both evidence and practice. So there is a lot of talk about this in the schools. I mean, that was actually decided in 2010. Not a lot has happened, I'm afraid. And I could talk for 10 minutes about that as well, why it hasn't happened, but I'm not going to do that. I think we need to distinguish a few different things here. It's, of course, we need more research that actually creates knowledge that is useful for teachers in their everyday practice. And of course, we need to engage teachers in that in different ways. But that's maybe 10 or 20% of the teachers who could be in different ways engaged in producing the knowledge. But I mean, 100% of our teachers should be able to use existing research, and we don't talk about that. And that's a great lack in teacher education. You do not have the tools when you come out from the Swedish teacher education to actually do that. To find it, to be able to read it, to be able to transform it into your practice, to be able to do a little systematic evaluation of what you are doing yourself, instead of just feeling that, it was pretty good. They seem to like it, and I think that's the big issue we have here. We can sort of construct databases, we can make fantastic reviews, but if we do not address the issue that teachers don't have the tools, at least in Sweden, I shouldn't generalize for the other countries, but that it's really a very neglected area. We also have a cultural resistance, of course, when it comes to these reviews, and you're lucky, Sylvie, you don't have to use the word evidence, because just to get across that is a big step. And you have, of course, a number of teachers who still think that teaching is an art. So, and I say it is an art because every job you have where you are concerned with human beings is some sort of an art and a personal thing. But it's also an intervention. I mean, teaching, you start somewhere, you end somewhere, you want something to have happened, and you want to be the one who actually saw to that change. And that's an intervention situation, really. So you need to have a continuous dialogue and discussion with teachers around these things. Since the concepts of evidence and evidence-based and evidence-informed teaching and all those sort of things catch a lot of resistance and emotions, we actually wrote a piece on that and sort of tell the world how we at the Institute interpret and use these concepts, and you find it there on the webpage for that little report. How do we work? Well, as I said, we want to produce systematic reviews that sort of target things that happen in the classroom. We are working very much with trying to find out what teachers need. And that's very difficult too. There's a lot of complexity and difficulties in this business. Because if you gather up a number of teachers and ask them, what do you need to know more about? You get answers that are lying very sort of high up, very generalized. We sort of lack a professional language. That's another thing we lack when it comes to teachers. You get the answers like, oh, we need to know more about inclusion. Okay, inclusion of whom, where, what ages, what subjects, what do you mean with inclusion? So in order to dig deeper into that, we're developing a way of having small focus groups on topics, we sort of choose pretty much the type of teachers. For instance, we started doing this with the preschool teachers, where we invite a number of preschool teachers, right, a generalized model is we invite a number of teachers within the area, and also a number of researchers in the same area. And what we do now is that we tell the teachers that before you come to the meeting, try to think of two or three dilemmas that you have in your teaching situation, Bring them to the meeting. And then we have small group discussions with teachers and researchers. And the point of departure in those discussions are those two or three dilemmas, to try and get closer to reality. I think it's an interesting way, and it's interesting to develop these things, I think, to actually get to know what we need to target in our reviews. We're thinking of doing a wide survey. We also have an online form where you can go in and just say, I think we need a review on this topic, and you have to give some more information about that. So, and we're also building a database around these issues, which when it's developed more, we are also going to make it open, because of course the Institute can't make reviews on all the different needs, but maybe some of us can, and maybe it can be interesting for researchers as well. We've had a pilot project in collaboration with the University of Gothenburg, Department of Philosophy, because I thought when I got into this job now that we can't just sort of produce these reviews and find good ways of sort of spreading them. We need to know what happens when they land in reality. And I was a bit lucky there and got in and just happened to get to know Professor Morten Sørgaard, Gothenburg University, who is running a master course in evidence basing. If you want to have a look at the course, you can log on to that, to their website there. And he was interested in taking part of that 15 ECTS and develop that according to the needs that I saw for a group of teachers. What do they need to know to be able to actually take something from our upcoming reviews and try it out in their classrooms, in their schools? They need to be able to do a little evaluation, a little study on that. So they started with doing 15 ECTS within his master course, and after that we worked together, and they've done a number of projects, and we actually had our final presentation of that together with their principals just a few days ago. It's been really interesting. And it's really interesting both to understand what happens when you take research results and actually apply them in the classroom and the teaching, but it's also very interesting to hear how these teachers use this type of literature and what happens with their colleagues. A lot to learn from that, actually. Okay, so that was our work with the systematic reviews. I'm going to say a few words about our research funding as well. We have a very small amount of money, 18 million Swedish crowns. And in our instruction, it just says that we should fund practice-based school research. So what is that? How do we develop that so we just don't get the ordinary proposals that that usually comes in funding situations for educational research? Well, what is it for a start? I think we can draw a lot of parallels to medical clinical research. And I think it was Nobel laureate or someone in the vicinity of that, anyway, a couple of years ago. And he said, excellent healthcare has clinical research pulsing in its veins. And I wouldn't be such a good researcher if I wasn't also a medical doctor. And it goes the other way as well. So I think we should use the same logic pretty much when it comes to practice-based school research. And oh my God, she's got so many. I'm pretty satisfied with it myself. this is sort of a definition of that type of research that we worked on over a few years here now. And of course it's work in progress, and I'm sure it can be better, but it should be research that is absolutely emanating from the questions and challenges which you meet on a daily basis. And it should be research that you can use to improve your methods and working practices. It should be research that presupposes school structures and resources. And it should be grounded on, and I'm using the concept of symmetrical relationships. I learned a lot from your article about teacher training. And I think that's the key issue here, to actually get two cultures, two types of professions, to have a dialogue with each other and understand that I can't do anything as good as I want to do unless I listen to you. Both. And it's so easy for us researchers to go into a context, and we're not evil people. We don't always want to take the floor, but everyone pushes us into that situation as well. So it really depends on both parties here. And that's what you really need to develop. So symmetrical partnership, that's really important in this type of research. This type of research, I think, in the long run, should also be able to initiate new type of research environments. It doesn't have to be at the universities. It has to have the same high quality, but we see in Sweden that in many different local council communities, they are building different types of units to support research and research use in the school system. And I can see that they can possibly be developed into new real research environments. I think it's important to think about research in terms of how to have some sort of time perspective when the results of research should become possible to use. And this should be stuff that can actually be pretty much implemented fairly soon after the project is finished, as opposed to, of course, foundational research. I mean, we need foundational research, of course. We need a lot of research around the school systems, about, you know, curriculum and all that sort of stuff that we have a lot of research about. And then we need this practice-based research. So it's not one or the other, but it seems to become very often in many systems. So how to make actual practice of this then? We decided to do the review, construct the review process in two steps, because what it really means, what we really have to do here, is to combine high scientific quality with relevance. How do you do that? There is a lot of educational researchers who believes that one sort of comes out the other. I've never understood that, but you know, there's a lot of culture issues here. We need to combine them. So we decided that we should have some obligators to start with before the proposals even went to the external review team. And we decided on three things. That the project must be based in a pre or in school environment, very close to the teaching situation. There's got to be a letter of intent or a contract between the university and the schools, and it should be signed by the head of the school, the principals. Not by the teachers who might be involved, and not by the people at the higher level in the system. We need to know that this is anchored at the schools that are involved. And the third thing is that the researched questions or topics should be formulated in dialogue with professionals from the schools. Then, of course, then we just have a regular external review process, except that we also have one evaluation field for relevance, where we look at a few different things, but one of the things we are looking at is the documentation about number three. How do they write up that they actually had a discussion with teachers in one way or another about the topic of the proposal. Because, you know, you can have a lot of collaboration for a number of years and things sort of grow out of that, or it could be one of things that, oh, I'm going to practice on another school, which was instituted, and I need some teachers. So, of course, there is a quality aspect of that as well. Some figures from our first two rounds. So the first first call was 2016. We had 107 applications there. Actually, we had 121 or something, but only 107 managed the three relevance criteria. So 107 went to the review group. Was 23 higher education institutions. We have about 35, just under 40. I think we have 25 where the teacher training is located. But anyway, something like that. So it's a good spread from the universities. And the first round produced 321 such agreements with schools. And as you can see, this year we had 94 applications from 21 universities with 233 agreements. Of course, in those two rounds, there will be the same schools involved. So it's not 554 schools involved. But I think we've done a lot very quickly. It's been very, there's a lot of positive reactions on this. And I think when it comes to these 500, I want to mention as well that last year, we haven't had time to do that yet, but last year we did a little questionnaire follow-up with the ones who didn't receive mine and asked them a number of questions. And we did ask them the question, what happened to your collaboration now? Has it stopped or do you still have some sort of contact with each other? And 60% said that we are still collaborating. Of course, format and, you know, don't have the money and the time and all that. And I would say there is a lot of bad quality research going on, of course, at many places. But this is the foundation, because people need to get to know each other, researchers and teachers and principals. They need to form a relationship and get to know each other and just mix and discuss, and things will grow out of that. And I think that's a key point, really. Oh yes, this is Institute of Education on Top of the World. This is just for fun, but this is the spread of the universities who do have signed agreements with a number of schools. So you can see that it's a good spread all over the country. It's not just a few higher education institutions, and that brings me back to what I said right in the beginning. We have in our instruction that we should fund research where there are sort of white patches on the map. But I believe that we have to go on just promoting this profile, what practice-based research really is. We should not start to do calls on some specific school subject or something like that, because that means that we're going to narrow down the number of researchers who are interested in this to a very small amount, which means that we don't drive the profile, we don't drive this type of research that really needs to be done on a much larger scale, but we will also end up in a situation where we can't hold the scientific quality, because Sweden is a small country and the number of researchers, it will be very small environments that will apply in that case. So two reasons for that, really, to go on to have the open calls when it comes to the content of the projects is the profile that we are interested in driving. And I must say that Sylvie is vice chair on our external review group and helped us a lot with that. I was very, very lucky when I started the organization around this to find out that Professor Mikael Alexandersson, who used to be university chancellor at one of the universities on the West Coast, was actually stepping down from his position, and he said yes when I asked him, could you help me to chair this? And he's been working with this type of research and teacher a lot. So that's been a very productive collaboration. And I think that was my last slide. Here, I will leave, you already have the PowerPoint, and these are just the titles of the projects that we funded. And this is the project from 2017. I can say that since we're so small,
And we've done and so few projects, I thought it would be an interesting thing to create a relationship with our project leaders instead of just being a boring governmental authority and asking them to write some results reports. So we invited them. So we've invited these guys twice actually. And a few days ago we had a whole day where they presented where they are in the projects. And we also asked them specifically to tell us, so what about the collaboration with the teachers now? Because in a number of these projects, they actually have teachers in the group. And it's interesting to hear both how this can actually really result in something new that wouldn't have happened unless both the researcher and the teacher were there. I'm not going to go into the details about that. But also an interesting situation that, for instance, that there is a very large turnover of principals, there is a large turnover of teachers, and you start off with a couple of teachers and you have a signed contract with one principal when you apply for the money, and when you start off there is a new principal and there is some other teachers are going to be involved in your project. So that's one interesting